we'll start. I think it's after 1 o'clock. And I'm Bob Hubbard. I'm in the New York AG's office. You know, what can I say? I usually don't give the disclaimer because anybody who thinks I'm Andrew Cuomo is probably very ill-advised to make that assumption. The only person I probably bind is my wife, and she doesn't like that. So, in any case, the format we're going to follow is to have you know, the author of the paper give you know, a quick overview, 3 to 5 minutes. Then we'll have the discussant give the reaction to it, and then Jay will give his practitioner kind of reaction. And I think we'll just start going now. And I'll just follow the procedure here with Salil. And why don't you Salil?
On a 14-degree day, so, you know, it's still a good idea. Okay, so the focus of the paper is on the idea of something that I call platform dominance, which is the idea that we now have the online world is dominated often by what I call platforms, software, devices, websites or online communities. So here you could think of Linux or, you know, certain phones like the iPhone or Wikipedia, whatever, Facebook. It's dominated by these things that are not necessarily going to amount to monopoly markets, right? We're not going to be monopolies under standard market definition. It'll be difficult to define the market, if you can. Think about the difficulties of defining whether a browser was a market in the DC Circuit's Microsoft case. And the reason I focus on this idea is because I think that even though these platforms may fall short of monopoly and being appropriate targets of monopolization under Section 2, I think there are real concerns here, and so I propose what is essentially an approach to regulating these areas. It is at the intersection of antitrust and consumer protection, and it's based on a change in the notion of where we get innovation from. So the reason is, in a number of these cases, right, in a number of, whether it's Linux, whether it's the iPhone and its applications, whether it's Wikipedia, we see a lot of user-generated content and a lot of user innovation. And it's not just the specific innovations that users on the demand side are producing, it's also the overall process of creation of content and innovation that is gathering steam, which I collectively call user dynamism. The reason I think that this dynamism is important, I mean, fundamentally, there's this idea we've inherited and promoted that we get, as our source of growth, much of that from dynamic effects, not from allocative efficiency, not from static efficiency, that innovation is critical. It also, I think, challenges some ideas that we've seen even pretty recently. If you think about Scalia in Trinco, which you reinforced in Linkline, there's this idea that, remember, the move from monopoly power being simply something antitrust is agnostic on to something that it has faith in, right? You know, in monopoly power we trust because it, as Scalia put it, it induces risk-taking that produces innovation, right? You can think about this too. We just had someone discussing Bork, right? Bork, remember, believed that the innovation was a function of consumer choice because consumers chose the degree to which innovation happened by the degree to which they made it profitable to innovate. These approaches, I think, we have to reconsider this idea if consumers are no longer sort of dumb terminals on a mainframe, that view of a network industry, but instead are engaging this process of user dynamism. And so what I propose in the paper is to think about it in terms of fostering competition across several dimensions. So when a platform owner or operator might promise, for example, this would be a normal example, allowing a certain level of freedom or room to play for the user to create versus a certain level of security of the platform overall, and maybe even other things, right? Like duration of these commitments. You could have competition across a number of dimensions that would foster user dynamism, but it's not going to work unless these commitments are credible. So what we need, I think, is essentially a way to make them credible. I talk in the paper about other approaches people have had, and whether it's sort of Yochai Benkler and sharing or network neutrality, infrastructure theories, and why they might not reach what I'm talking about, either because they're more ambitious or because they're sort of orthogonal to the point I'm getting at. The idea here, though, is that if we can foster credible commitments, then we can have competition on these multiple dimensions. So who would do this? How could we do this? Why do I think this is possible? I build on, since I think it's unlikely that essential facilities is going to make a strong comeback under Section 2, I build on, for a variety of reasons, I instead build on the FTC's experience under Section 5, and not just the standard setting cases. I do think the standard setting cases are somewhat analogous to the concern I'm talking about, except that I think the concern I'm talking about is actually stronger than the concern in the standard setting cases. If you think about the majorist dissent, for example, in NData, she takes the position that, this is really a commercial matter. It's not a consumer concern. And that these, this as a policy matter, these are big players. The users in these of these platforms are actually very, very poorly placed, I think, to protect their own interests. In addition to the fact that they are dispersed and diffuse, they're also not necessarily the ones who will benefit from the innovations they're making. Those people may be several years later. The other thing I look at is the FTC's consumer protection experience with respect to online privacy under Section 5, where not only have they enforced commitments and said, okay, you not only cannot say you're going to keep people's data, for example, secure and then not do it, but you actually have to, if you make commitments to, say, a customary level of security, you have to actually reach a customary level, which suggests some ability to both translate these commitments over time, as well as a way to generate a certain level of industry consensus on what that custom might be, and to create this sort of trust in these platforms. So just as a last take on this, I think ultimately what I'm trying to do here is, I'm not naive. I realize that regulation, it could really have problems just like any other regulation. This could. It's not going to be perfect, but it does potentially create an institutional path to increasing trust that promotes some of the same interests, innovation chief among them, that antitrust normally is concerned with.
Spencer?
Thanks, Bob. Thanks to Harry and Danny and NYU and the ABA. I think this is great, and I hope this experiment gets repeated and institutionalized. It's a terrific innovation. My comments, it was fun to read this, and I want to put this in context. Salil has a draft. I know he's got sort of places marked where there's more work to be done, and it's a work in progress, and I want to address it in those terms. As I said in Jerry Maguire, you had me at infrastructure. I'm very sympathetic to arguments that talk about open access to things that we can, rightly call infrastructure, platform monopolies, that sort of thing. And I understand that you're trying to really expand that perspective beyond situations where even more cheerful readings of Section 2 and essential facilities would go. And, I think it's a legitimate problem, and I think you're really tackling an important and timely issue in both competition policy and IP, and that's the nature of networks and platforms and what's the best competition policy, even if it goes beyond the narrow definition of antitrust law. And I think, and I applaud you're trying to tackle the relationship of that broad competition policy to other interests such as consumer protection and privacy. I mean, you don't start to get into that very explicitly, but I think that's an underlying theme to your paper. So my remarks are really to find areas that are in this paper that Salil has either teed up in a footnote or mentioned that he's going to be doing more with, and kind of my trying to highlight the ones that I think would be the most helpful as this evolves. And I think he's tackled big issues. And there's a tension when you're writing articles, particularly at more junior stages of the career. Can you write the 25, 30-page essay where you tee up a cool idea you know, and leave the heavy lifting for later, or do you really want to go sort of the full Monty and do a, you know, 60, 70 page article that really solves everything? Let me just suggest to you that I think you've got to, this paper isn't going to be the tiny little essay. I think, it's going to be a big chunky article down the road. I agree with your thesis. I think it's interesting. I think it's possible. The basic idea is if a operator of a software or technology platform makes a commitment, they're legally bound by it, and the FTC should enforce it, perhaps as a matter of consumer protection, not antitrust under Section 5. I'm concerned that you've made Kodak the hook for your argument, and that maybe either be placement in terms of where it appears in the article or emphasis. I don't think it's a bad analogy, but Kodak and the copiers and the aftermarkets and the parts is technically neither the platform monopoly that you're talking about nor particularly the network effect stuff that you're also talking about. I'm also only concerned that, as a matter of strategy, Kodak itself hasn't proved to be as robust a theory in subsequent cases, and I think that's something that Ariel also has in his paper as well. So as you move from Kodak to your more general concerns about platforms, I'd like to see you more information about which of the two aspects of Kodak is more important and why. Is it the information costs for consumers sort of at the front end, or is it the switching costs at the back end? And just explaining why, whatever you think is the more, whatever combination of them you find particularly troublesome that would leave consumers locked into a platform and unable to protect themselves from opportunistic behavior. Again, despite my sympathy and my general agreement with the article, as a matter of litigation strategy, I'm always concerned when anybody trots out Section 5 of the FTC Act. And I would just urge you, as a matter of strategy of getting from where you want to be to where you want to end up, to consider the critiques that and the writing and speeches that Bill Kovacic in particular has about this, where he just says, we've been there, we've tried that, it hasn't worked so well. Name me the last time the FTC has won on Section 5 in a monopoly-like context, and apparently the answer is a very long time ago in the 20s mm-hmm. or 30s, I don't remember the name of the case. He has a well-articulated but debatable view of why the courts don't take the FTC as seriously as they ought to and what would have to be done in order for that to happen. Now, there's a flip side to that, and it's interesting that they're both current commissioners. Commissioner Pamela Jones-Harbor is also interested, particularly on the privacy side, and these connections between competition and privacy policy, and she has interest in Section 5 as a tool for that, and I just urge you to think about that. I would urge you to think about, as you tee up in the footnotes, the critiques of NData, both from then-Commissioner Majoris and other people who've written about it. And obviously, it's sort of too soon to tell what's going to happen with Intel in that case. So again, most of my comments are things that I hope you consider more explicitly, where you already allude to them in certain places. I don't think you can just mention Schumpeter without talking more about it, particularly because so much of what you're talking about of necessity raises this competition for the market and his metaphor of the waves of creative destruction and all that. Again, I'd like to see more about network effects directly rather than just by analogy. And I would say in analogizing the three main models that you talk about, I'd also suggest you talk about some other related ideas that I think you acknowledge but I believe deserve greater prominence. One is not just the infrastructure stuff that Brett Frischman and I and others have written about, but the stuff that Frischman and Mark Lemley do about spillovers that's a little different, and we can get into the details off mic if you want, but I view that as a broader theory. You allude to it in different places in the paper later on. I think Kevin Werbach's work on interconnection is another related idea that deserves more prominence. And I'd also suggest at least thinking about, if it doesn't expand the paper too much, bringing that comparative lens to bear that you've done in much of your other work. How have other legal systems albeit in other institutional contexts, addressed similar problems. And then finally, because you're talking about a problem at the intersection of competition and consumer policy and using Section 5, I hope you would think about the Bob Land, Neil Averett line of articles and arguments about consumer sovereignty as the ultimate goal of both areas of the law, and how maybe this is another example where Section 5 is a better way of bringing these policy areas together, and a very traditional one. Something, the more you make people comfortable that this is a traditional problem and you're using traditional tools to solve it, the less concerns I have about the Section 5 argument. So when you get to your theory of platform dominance, you have in the paper a number of great specific examples. I know you got a footnote that says I'm going to get to it. I urge you to get to it, because I think a very effective structure in any law review article is to have, you know, a problem, a solution, and you know, without boring the reader, two or three or four examples. Goes back to the other panel. How would things come out differently if we did it your way versus whatever happened? I think the ones you mentioned in the footnotes or in the text are great. Let's see. As the paper moves on, you seem to be moving from opportunistic behavior, where the platform operator changes something, to general concerns about harm to downstream users and innovations, even if they're not changing it. Now, maybe I misread it, or maybe it just needs to be clarified. But if I'm reading that correctly, and what you're really worried about is just non-deceptive platforms that are being restricted as to the downstream uses, then I think you actually are closer to the infrastructure and spillover theories that you mentioned, but you're trying to distinguish a little bit. I also think, very minor quibble, I think the FTC standard cases are a direct application of what you're advocating and not really an analogy. I think they're the perfect example. My concern is this. If your proposal is adopted and it becomes a violation of FTC Section 5, if you make a representation as to use of data or other terms and conditions of this platform or network, and you change it, that's the violation. I'm concerned about a world in which the response is everybody, or almost everybody, engages in a race to the bottom, where you end up with widespread use of weasel words that give you a wide discretion to do whatever the heck you want down the road, and no one can claim they've been deceived, but still produce that suboptimal world that you're worried about. And I think you at least need to address that, either why it isn't going to happen, or what you want to do about it if it does. So in the end, I like where you're heading. I agree with your general thesis. I just don't think this can be a quick essay, and I think I'm looking forward to this bigger, more comprehensive piece with these concrete examples. And I think the general strategy of anticipating and rebutting the mainstream non-crazy arguments, you know, that are on the other side. Thanks.
Thank you, Spencer. Jay?
Don't take this the wrong way. I had great difficulty understanding the paper. Spencer clearly didn't. I didn't understand what the problem was. I thought your explanation here, by the way, was much better than anything in the paper. And so maybe we can hope it's transcribed. I really don't know what the competitive problem is that you're speaking to. I thought the notion of platform was, to me at least, not adequately spelled out. You mentioned, I think you mentioned Linux Today. I don't understand what the problem is that's associated with Linux. You know, it's certainly a vibrant platform in which there's an enormous user base and user contribution. I don't see the competitive issue that's associated with it, and I don't see the risk of commitments related to Linux, which is, after all, nothing but a description of 500 different operating systems out there, you know, that started with the same kernel. I don't know where there's a user lock in there. I guess I could understand it more if we referred to Apple. But I think the lock-in there is not simply by virtue of a software platform, but rather the overall product offerings that Apple creates and you know, integrates, including both hardware and software, obviously. So, as I said, I don't understand from the paper the problem, and therefore, it was hard for me to see what it was you were trying to solve. And I don't know exactly what your examples are of platform dominance, where users are today being locked in. I guess, you know, yes, I see it in Apple, and I even see it in open source, but only because you know, there are things that aren't interoperable with open source. But it's not because the open source community is flipping commitments. So I'm sorry that I can't be, you know, happier. And I will respond to comments that you have because they might help me.
Okay, so.
Unless that's not allowed.
Yeah.
No, that's how I prefer.
To go back to this idea, it's not only a lock-in argument, actually. So I realize that I think
I didn't pretend to understand it.
Yeah,
that's okay.
I think Spencer's onto something when he says maybe not emphasize Kodak so much. It's primarily an argument of opportunism and a concern for undermining a process of user dynamism. This, not only the actual specific user-created content or innovation, but actually the growth of this as a way consumers act and as something they value. And so, in that sense, I don't know if that helps.
Where is the competitive issue, though?
The competitive issue is the loss of the dynamic effects if you undermine user confidence because they can't rely on commitment. So the easiest example, I think, is if you look at what we have going on in mobile phones, cell phones right now, where you have the established, you have the iPhone, it has the massive app store, right? It's interesting, actually, because I don't want to take a lot of time here, but 2 years ago, the iPhone was seen as this incredibly non-generative platform. People really smart, smarter than I am, right, said it was going to kill the internet, right? But it turns out, right, actually, it's a great spawn, or not a great spawn, it's a great prod to this user dynamism. So we get a competitor, right? We get something like Google Android, which makes a promise mm-hmm. to allow you not only to create, but to actually change the operating system to be very open. Well, what happens, you know, 2-3 years later, right? To what extent are these commitments enforceable?
You also get
enforceable?
A Palm Pre, which is a third competitor.
You've got even more, right, so. Exactly. And so the question is, suppose, you know, somebody gets the installed base, it's not only lock-in, because some of these things might be portable, but it's also that it may destroy or damage the ability to convince people to participate. If you you know, I should have been clearer with more examples. I should have.
Well,
it should
you know,
be a
the
7,
example
000.
You choose though is interesting because it's one where yes, indeed, you have platforms and yes, indeed, you have a user community writing for them, but you also have you have nascent competitors, certainly the Droid and the Palm Pre that are trying to do the same thing. So you say, what would happen if Apple suddenly, you know, pulled the rug out from under the user community? Well, I think they'd move to the actual, you know, the competitors like the Google Droid or the Pre if they can, you know, last long enough. The lock-in, the problem that consumers face is the lock-in of the phone to the service. I don't, you know, nobody is really complaining about their inability to write, you know, need apps for the iPod at the moment, except insofar as Apple may be censoring the kinds of apps that they don't like. But anyway, I sort of find that to be a circumstance where there's not really a competitive issue at the moment.
Actually, there are developers who complain about the review process, particularly the delays.
Sure.
And that's been a pretty, and those developers range from, you know, the people in their garages to somebody who's a great deal more substantial, right? And so, you know, the point is not that we lose a few apps. The point is that to the extent that this we have this picture of a new sort of level of supply of demand side innovation or content creation, you might undermine the trust in this. I mean, there are, I can give you examples that are less. I mean, I will not. I don't think I want to take up this panel's entire time, but the paper will eventually go into another example of something where really everyone contributed, I think, for free was Wikipedia, right? Where a year and a half ago there was a crisis because the foundation that owns it, or rather the individual who controls the foundation, considered an exclusive license for cell phones. In other words, it would continue to be the way it is on the internet, but if you were going to use it on a cell phone, it was going to be exclusively one provider. That was quickly shot down. But you can see where there's a question of how do you translate the commitments they made early on in convincing millions to participate and create.
I'd also like, if you'd like to respond to Spencer's comments, I'd invite you to do that too.
Thank you, Spencer. Actually, that was really incredibly helpful. This is the struggle I have, actually. Yours was also helpful. I was just answering the question posed.
I'm not proud. I'm leaving here at the end of the day.
Okay, so it's a struggle I've had because obviously this is at a pretty early stage, and I've been trying to think, well, in what order should this paper proceed, and how do I stay under 20,000 words? To the extent that a lot of your comments are really helpful in terms of both giving me the scope of things to consider as well as some triage, I think.
And why don't we move on to next? You want to go next, Hillary?
Okay. There we go. Thank you. Okay. Does this have to be green? Oh, no.
Yeah, it's red there.
Thanks. Greetings. It's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you in particular to the folks that organized this event and for inviting me. Now, my paper is about expressive boycotts. We'll call them alleged expressive boycotts, just to be safe. And they're undertaken by a range of really suspect characters. Those suspect characters include scientists, doctors, and academics. And the discourse generated by those boycotters transcends the transactions that are nominally involved. And what these boycotts reflect is a desire to engage in public discourse on a range of broad issues, including the relationship between patents and scientific progress, humanitarian limits on for-profit pricing of medicine, and the relationship between intellectual property and information sharing in academic environments. Now, unfortunately, the antitrust laws are already arguably chilling and could be used to actually silence such expressive boycotts. And this state of affairs reflects not only antitrust failure to recognize non-economic values, which in this case, speech, but also the First Amendment's failure to stand up for itself. And in response, I say, a pox on both your houses. And I think that's the legal term of art. And in particular, I take aim at the Supreme Court's ruling in Superior Court Trial Lawyers. And as you will recall, the case involved private attorneys who agreed to boycott providing legal services to indigent criminal defendants unless the government increased their compensation. Now, in a divided Supreme Court ruling, the majority said that there was no speech interest involved and condemned the boycott as per se illegal. It condemned it in the same manner as it would any price fixing that occurs in the sort of proverbial smoke-filled room. And the court's reasoning was twofold. The first reason was it manufactured, meaning the majority, an unnecessary but fatal incompatibility between political speech and economic interest on the part of the speaker. Having done so, it then disingenuously proceeded to require that a per se rule was necessary. Now, my general allegiances, not surprisingly, lie with the dissent, which found that there was some element of protected speech within the expressive boycott, and they would have required the application of a rule of reason. Now, I say my allegiance is with the dissent, but I think that the dissent has some particular limitations. The first of which is the scope of protected speech needs to be considered as broader than that which is political, political being defined as that which is meant to sort of address and provoke change from the legislature. The second thing is that while the dissent endorses a rule of reason because of the posture of the case, they didn't actually have to put much meat on the bones. And I think that the same impulse that necessitates the rejection of the per se rule also requires that when you adopt a rule of reason, that the rule of reason be implemented somewhat differently. And in particular, I think attention needs to be paid to how we define a conspiracy or identify a conspiracy, because the sort of conventional but-for analysis is going to be difficult in contexts with non-economic motivation. And then secondly, there is going to be additional trouble attendant to assessing whether or not there is a competitive harm. How do you know something is a result? A boycott is successful as a result of the market power on the part of the boycotters versus, you know, persuasion broadly defined. So in closing, much of my research has explored the role of trade-offs in antitrust. And while I don't think that antitrust's aversion to recognizing non-economic factors is defensible substantively, I can say that sort of as I was trying to work through how I would put the meat on the bones of a rule of reason, I appreciate the difficulty attendant to it, so I understand why having something that's cut and dry is attractive. With that said, I think that it's still important to try to come to a better outcome, and in fact, I think that a better outcome that's still administrable is possible.
Thank you. Marina?
Thank you. Well, I'd also like to thank all the organizers, particularly Danny, for organizing this. I enjoyed the paper very much. I think Hillary gave three excellent examples involving scientists, people who, if they were defendants, would be very sympathetic defendants, who were collectively refusing to deal, if you will, in order to protest.
Unlike lawyers, right?
in order to protest firms that who were pricing in a way that they felt was not in the social good, and for their IP licensing restrictions that were also perhaps contrary to the greater social good. The actors were economically self-interested, but they also had social motives. And Hillary notes that under existing First Amendment antitrust laws, the refusal to deal might not be protected because it goes beyond speech. Once you go beyond speech to act to restrain trade, then you would have to, at least our law seems to suggest that you would have to show that the people have no, the participants have no economic self-interest in the boycott before there would be immunity. Otherwise, regular antitrust law would apply. And the paper disagrees with this approach, arguing that conventional antitrust law should not apply to expressive boycott. And Hillary defines an expressive boycott as a boycott involving self-interested, economically self-interested individuals, but also has a political speech involved, political defined more broadly to include social aspects as well. And she then proposes doing away with the per se rule at all, even with restraints like the Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association type of case, and to impose a modified per se rule of reason, which as I read it is really more lenient than the usual rule of reason, slightly more lenient than the usual rule of reason. And I'm very sympathetic toward the boycott participants in the three examples that Hillary used, and I appreciate the desire to formulate a rule that would shield them from antitrust immunity, from antitrust liability. But I have a certain dilemma here because I have some concerns about the implications of the proposal, especially on professional self-regulation. Okay, because I think every boycott involving professionals can be phrased in terms of political speech, as political speech is defined by Hillary. Because if you think about the major professional association type of cases that we have, all of us know about, professional engineers, Indiana Federation of Dentists, and of course, Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association, you can see how all of them can be considered expressive speech, right? And professional engineers, the no bidding rule can easily be rephrased in terms of a boycott, which is the engineers agree not to not to take customers who insist on talking about prices prior to signing the retainer agreement. Similarly, in the Indiana Federation of Dentists case, the dentists are saying that we think that outside interference with our care for our patients is not good, and we will not do anything to facilitate that by submitting x-rays to the insurance companies. And of course, in the Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association case, the lawyers are saying that underpaying us is not good for society because our clients would not be adequately represented. So in all three cases, you're really talking about some political speech. But at the same time, in all three cases, you are also talking about participants who have a substantial and direct self-interest in the result. So I guess it leads to the second comment that I have, and I think I'd like a little bit more clarification on what the proposal is. Do you intend the proposal to apply to all expressive boycotts as long as the political content is not feigned, I think is what you said, and that as long as they are bona fide, then the special rule would apply? Or are you suggesting that the special rule will only apply if the political speech aspects of it predominates over the economic self-interest? Because I think depending on which route you're taking, it makes a difference. If you're saying that it only applies to boycotts, expressive boycotts, where the political speech aspect predominates, then I wouldn't have problems with it, except I think it's very difficult to balance things that are not balanceable, right? How do you balance political content of the speech against economic self-interest? But then if you take the position, which I think your paper takes, is that as long as the speech is not contrived, but is good faith, okay, no matter how minuscule that content is, then the special rule would apply, then I would think that then almost all professional self-regulation that can be phrased in terms of a boycott would fall into that category. And if that's the case, then I guess I'm a little bit concerned because then I think it would be good to have some sort of limiting principle that would work perhaps a little bit better to avoid these situations where there might be a little bit of over-inclusive. At the end, I think, of the paper, or toward the latter part of the paper, you talked about some things that we could look at in the nature of the boycott to determine whether it is a bona fide speech interest or whether it is a feigned or contrived interest. And I think they were very good, the characteristics. You said, let's look at the dialogue. You look at to see whether the boycott was able to attract outsiders to support it. I think they're very helpful in determining how substantial the political content of the speech is. I'm not entirely sure that it can tell us the distinction between bona fide speech and contrived speech, because I think most people have, many professionals have mixed motives, right? So let's say the lawyers in the professional engine, the lawyers in the California Superior Court Trial Lawyers Association case, we're really mostly unhappy with what they're being paid. But at the same time, they also have a generalized sense about the inequities of the criminal system, right? You can't really say that their political speech is contrived or feigned. But at the same time, if there was evidence to show that their economic interest really is really predominant and the other political interest is subordinate to it, then do we want to give them the flexibility of this very, very liberal rule that you are suggesting? So that's one thing. The sacrifice test that you mentioned, the paper mentioned that sacrifice is a distinctive feature of expressive boycott, and it suggests that when sacrifice is present, the boycott was probably motivated by broader social objectives than might by economic interest, and I think you're implicit in that. The implication is that those who engage in pure economic boycotts would have been unwilling to sacrifice, and that's how you could tell the distinction between the two. I'm not sure that that's valid, and I think because the reason I don't think it's valid is because I think short-term sacrifice is almost always involved in not always, but often involved in conventional boycotts, unless the boycotted firm capitulates right away, right? And in fact, when you think of exclusionary and predatory practices, there's almost always sacrifice involved. A good example was predatory pricing, right? The firm sacrifices to take immediate losses so as to be able to get super competitive profits later on. And in fact, in recent years, economists and Doug Melamed as well and Greg Worden has developed this sacrifice test, basically to ask whether the conduct is exclusionary or not. So with that, I'm not sure we can draw any valid inferences about a boycotter's motives from his or her her willingness to endure short-term sacrifice. On the issue of anti-competitive effect, your paper proposes that in addition to showing actual market effects such as higher prices or lower prices, depending on whether the boycotters are buyers or sellers, the plaintiff has to also show that the effect is the result of economic coercion and not shame or other non-economic pressure that was brought to bear on the boycotted firm. And I agree that theoretically that it's good, but as you indicated, boycotts usually involve sacrifice, right? So you would assume that the boycotting firms would not resort to a boycott unless other options did not work. So unless the lobbying, the parading in front of City Hall, the shaming and the pressure did not work. It's only when that happens that you would resort to sacrifice. So if that's the case, why would you want to impose an additional burden on the plaintiffs? Is it necessary, or do you want to perhaps just put an additional burden on the plaintiff because you think that these should be protected in any event? I think I'm running out of time. I don't even know what the time is. I'm very sympathetic to the idea that
time,
do
yeah.
I? Am I?
Yeah, no, you have enough time. You could go 5 more minutes easily.
Really?
If you'd like. Yeah.
Okay. If that's the case,
if I'm looking at this, you know, I figure half an
case,
hour
I'll
for each paper.
I'll just perhaps make one additional point on the conspiracy. I think you actually made a very good point on conspiracy, on how the usual conscious parallel conduct and plus factor approach of interstate circuit doesn't work very well for expressive boycotts. And I think you're right, because plus factors assumes that if unilateral action is contrary to the self-interest of the person engaging in it, then it's a plus factor to which you can add on to the conscious parallel conduct and infer agreement. So it is correct, but at the same time, I'm not so sure you need to devote so much discussion to it, because it's not a major issue in boycotts, right? In expressive boycotts, because in expressive boycotts, you're assuming that the people are, or at least we think that there's a lot of dialogue, there's a lot of assent, and so agreement would be quite explicit. And to the extent that there's direct evidence of an agreement, you wouldn't need to resort to interstate circuit to infer the existence of an agreement from circumstantial evidence. So I'm really sympathetic to the idea that the court should be willing to look at non-economic factors in a rule of reason analysis. If we can find a way to do so, that will work out well. And I don't know how you could do it, but I think that if we can put in some workable limiting principle to the proposal so that all of these professional self-regulation activities would not somehow become immunized, that would be great.
Jay?
Okay, I'm sympathetic to the notion that antitrust ought to be able to tolerate expressive boycotts. I also would agree that I don't think conspiracy is an issue in this context at all, because by definition the effort is organized, and it's to really be what you expect it to be, it has to be public. That's what makes it expressive. people have to be able to see it and understand it. So it's not really an issue of conspiracy. I actually thought that this your approach was more a solution in search of a problem, because I'm not sure that the existing case law is very bad. I don't have a great deal of difficulty from an antitrust point of view, from a First Amendment point of view, with professional engineers, or the dentist case, or the trial lawyer's case. Those are all supplier side cases, where suppliers were, you know, in one way or another, trying to reduce output or control the availability of services. The boycotts that you seemed most worried about were the end user buyer situation. The scientists who are concerned with the genetically engineered mice and think that both the prices are too high and the conditions of licensing too restrictive. The Norvir case, where the doctors are effectively the proxies for the patients. And the buyer side boycott at the end user level seems to me a very sympathetic place to impose First Amendment values and to protect, and indeed to protect through an immunization process rather than by a more lenient or indulgent rule of reason process. I was sort of taken by the notion that I don't think I'd feel much better if I were a professor sued under your new and improved rule of reason standard than if I were just sued under the ordinary rule of reason standard. I'm going to be stuck in that lawsuit. I'd much rather have the motion to dismiss on the grounds that my conduct is expressive and protected by the First Amendment, and I think most of the end user kinds of boycotts in this area, you know, would be suitable for that kind of resolution rather than try to turn them into antitrust cases when they're probably not. The end user concerted action to secure lower prices or to secure less restrictive licensing terms ought to be beneficial, ultimately ought to enhance consumer welfare if they're successful. I would distinguish that from the, the sugar kind of middle person boycott, where I think you do, it's hard to describe that as expressive in the same kind of way, and you ought to apply conventional antitrust analysis to that kind of case, the Manville Farms sort of case that made clear that buyer boycotts, could be prosecuted as per se violations. The only, I think, other Supreme Court case that really matters here is the Claiborne Hardware case, and that's, of course, an end user a boycott in response to race discrimination, and the Supreme Court had no real difficulty immunizing that. I think that's a satisfactory result. The market share filters that come out of your rule of reason analysis seem to me would be very problematic to apply. You have a sort of I forget what the threshold is, market share, and then you said it doesn't matter if it doesn't reach that threshold. But if you could figure out a way to get past the threshold, you're stuck then, in an arguable market share analysis and a price impact analysis that, as I said, if I were a professor or a physician sued, I really wouldn't want to be in. I don't think you've offered them very much. So while I agree with you that it would be good to have a legal regime that does indeed recognize there's an important First Amendment value to expressive boycotts, I think at least where you're worried about end-user boycotts, I'd prefer to deal with it as an immunization doctrine rather than a more lenient rule of reason.
Hillary?
Great. Thank you both so much for your comments, and I'm wishful thinking, but I'm going to go in reverse order just because this is your comments are fresher in my mind. First of all, one of the things that I the paper is organized, so I spend most of my time talking about my recommendations, but I actually spend a fair amount of time saying these are my recommendations and this is my non-recommendation. And what I what I discuss at length as my non-recommendation is immunization. And, you know, my roots are actually doing a lot of First Amendment work, so I felt actually internally a struggle to sort of why am I not going there automatically? And, you know, will I be able to sort of justify my First Amendment credentials that way? And I felt pretty good not going there. And I'll tell you why. It's because I think that immunization, number one, is not, I feel that immunization isn't warranted if we actually are valuing competition principles, number one. And number two, I think that immunization opens the door for an incredible gaming of the system. It's unclear to me that, notwithstanding some of the caveats that you built in terms of how you would apply it to only end user boycotts, et cetera, I think that there's a lot of room in the proposal that I have for gaming of the system if you allow for immunization, because if you allow for immunization, then you're basically going to be inviting people to feign speech. You know, I want to do price fixing. If I can get it under the First Amendment umbrella, I'm immunized, so let me sort of gerrymander some sort of speech that I want to attach to it. So the reason why I didn't go the immunization route was that that was one of the things that
could
was
foremost.
Could
you give an example? I'm an end user buyer. How would you price fix?
Well, let me talk about the fact that I think that the end user, you're sort of proposing a different frame. So what I was talking about was a generalized frame in which it didn't matter whether the boycotters were buyers or sellers. And one of the reasons why I chose not to go with just a strictly end user format was that, and this goes to sort of the other part of the paper, which I'm really not engaging at this point, is these are IP-related boycotts. All of the boycotts were attendant to some sort of intellectual property. Why is that relevant? There's a very unique relationship between the buyers and sellers in this case. They keep flipping up and back. You can look at the doctors in the Norvir case and you could say the doctors are somehow buyers of the drugs as sort of, you know, surrogates for the patients. On the other hand, the doctors were also sellers. Why? They were actually giving their services or selling their services to, the drug companies because they were the ones that were conducting the clinical trials, et cetera. If you look at the example dealing with the publishing industry, same sort of interrelationship. On the one hand, you look at it and say, well, the academics or the libraries are the purchasers of these publishing, of these periodicals. On the other hand, they're also the suppliers. They're giving the inputs. They're giving the labor that enable these academic publications to sort of continue. Secondly, when it comes to the issue of Claiborne hardware, which I think is a sort of a very good point, two things on that. First of all, the Supreme Court never actually addressed the antitrust issue. The antitrust issue was thrown out at the state Supreme Court level as a result of NOR, okay? And so it never got up to the Supreme Court. One of the reasons why I discussed the case at length in the article is because I feel like it is being misused by the Supreme Court and Superior Court trial lawyers. The other thing that I would comment on with Claiborne, which goes to your point about end user boycotts, is that in the oral argument for Superior Court trial lawyers, one of the attorneys, Will Tom, for the trial lawyers, argued before the Supreme Court that if you were to consider that boycott under the per se rule that was proposed by the Federal Trade Commission, that boycott might fail as well. And that's because there was a very small number, among other things, there was a small number of people in the boycott that owned stores that benefited from it. Additionally, there was one demand in the petition by the boycotters to the Claiborne County, government effectively that said that more jobs had to be supplied, or at least one job per store had to be supplied to a person of color. And so what you end up doing is, I feel like they, the sort of the easy distinction between economic and non-economic.
Suppose you'd subjected that boycott to a, you know, rule of reason under your analysis. How do you think it would have come out?
Well, I can tell you.
Would it have been good?
Would the Superior Court.
Imagine the boycotted store bringing that case.
Right. Well,
against the participants in the boycott.
Right.
And imagine they're having, they're relying on your test.
Right.
Do you think that would have been a good result, better than what the result that came out of the Supreme Court's decision?
Well, the Supreme Court never ruled. You're talking about
I don't find much difference between the tortious interference doctrine here and the antitrust doctrine. The Supreme Court ruled on the tortious interference doctrine, right?
Right. I don't know whether or not there would be enough difference there, but I think that actually my test would potentially allow for the I would want to see the boycott vindicated as an instance of free speech, and I think that my test allows for it, because among other things, when I'm looking at the question of whether or not there is a speech interest, there are a lot of factors, one of which has to do with whether or not there's a substantial and direct economic interest, okay? And so in that case, you have a very tenuous interest on the part of a very small number of boycotters. And what's most important about it is the interest that they have is not in the outcome of the boycott. The interest that they had was in the duration of the boycott. And that's where it's critically different than Superior Court. In Superior Court, who wins? The boycotters win economically if the boycott is successful. In Claiborne County Hardware, who won? The people that had the economic interest only won during the duration of the boycott, because they own the competing stores. So I think that it's actually a different thing. So I think, yes, that on my test, Claiborne County would actually, not Claiborne County, the boycotters in Claiborne County would prevail. So I would be very happy with that outcome under my test.
But do you think it would have been an easier or harder litigation?
I don't think that it would have necessarily been that much harder of a litigation, but assuming arguendo that it was harder litigation, the question then becomes, is it better to have a test that is more searching and is more likely to arrive at the correct answer? Or do you want a test that's going to allow only a small sliver of boycotts to pass with no hurdles and no sort of real critical analysis, and then have another set of boycotts potentially condemned? So if the trade-off is having a more sensitive test that makes some people that should really sail through have to work a little harder before they're vindicated, but it also prevents some false positives, then on balance, I'm going to be in favor of that test.
I'm going to push you. If you want to have a quick response to Marina, that would be good too.
I would love to.
Okay.
And once again, I really am grateful for the comments. One of the things that I included that I viewed as a limiting principle was the rule of reason. Okay? The idea that there's not a limiting principle would be a function of if I had gone with immunization. The fact that a professional organization is sort of the framework you proposed would be able to advocate a speech right as defined under my proposal doesn't get them in the old, under the old rule, it would be you've articulated a speech right, get out of jail free, you're done. My proposal is you've articulated some, bona fide speech or interest, congratulations, you're now into a modified rule of reason. And so I don't view this as a situation in which you end up sort of just sort of giving everybody a free pass. And I think that it's sort of what comes to mind is the idea that in almost every area of antitrust law, we're more than happy to invoke the rule of reason. And we think that that's actually a good rule, even though, of course, there's problems and it may not be, very clearly applied and blah, blah, blah. But we seem to be relatively happy with the rule of reason. All I'm saying is that if you articulate a bona fide speech interest, then you get into the rule of reason. Now what I do, once you're in the rule of reason, as I say, the same characteristics that made the expressive conduct worthy of some sort of protection also mean that the rule has to be applied a little differently. And I'm just going to sort of flag very briefly, I swear, two characteristics. One of which is I do think it's critical to distinguish between an actual anti-competitive effect and just an effect. I have a boycott, and a few other people boycott, but we are really, really great with PR. So the boycott target, has only lost 1% of their market, a half percent of their market. But the press they are getting is horrendous. They buckle to my boycott. Is that a function of my market power? No. So that's one of the reasons why I think it's critical for us to come in and ask, you know, what exactly is the sort of, why did we get a reaction from the boycott target? We can't presume that it's a function of just market power, because you could have instances in which very few people boycotted, but the press is horrendous. And my last point goes on the issue of sacrifice. And I think that that's a place where I need to sort of work to clarify better why it's in there. To me, the notion of sacrifice is not, and I'm forgetting the sort of the way you framed it, but from my perspective, the idea of sacrifice is important because it's an indicia of commitment. What we need to do is we need to ask ourselves as a society, is there something important about allowing people to not only complain, have petitions, and, you know, sort of walk around the block with signs or whatever, but is there something additional that's important to actually allowing them to boycott? And as a practical matter, I think that, you know, our country recognizes, and a lot of cases have recognized, that boycotts that involve a sacrifice on the part of the boycotters indicate and send a message to the community writ large about how intensely they feel about something. If you have someone who complains about a product and continues to buy it, and someone who complains about a product that they might need and says, and I'm not going to buy it, there's a different intensity in the message and a different nature of the message that's being conveyed. And my concern is that antitrust should not be used like a blunt instrument to sort of tamp down on some of those messages and not others.
Okay, I'm sorry we have to move on, but we do. Ariel.
Okay, thanks very much for the organizer for inviting me or inviting all of us here. And I was also particularly happy that Eleanor Fox was assigned as a commentator on my paper, because I don't think Eleanor knows, but actually a paper that she wrote in 2005 motivated me to write this paper, although it took me a while to actually start doing that. Okay, also this is a paper that is co-authored with Paul Eric Veal, who is a brilliant former student who now is a clerk at the Supreme Court of Canada. Okay, and a last comment before I start my short presentation is that I may be overclaiming during this very short presentation, partly because it is very short, so I don't have a lot of time to get into the nuances, and also because it's snoozing time. So I hope that perhaps by overclaiming I may provoke you a little bit. Okay, so let me start. So the title of the paper is Beyond Essential Facilities, Innovation, Intellectual Property, and Competition Policy Across the Atlantic. And it starts with the observation that over the last few decades, the European Commission and the European Court of Justice have taken the view that a refusal to license intellectual property may, under special circumstances, amount to an abuse of dominant position, and that in such cases, the owner of the IP may be forced to license it to others. The three, I think, most well-known cases that embraced this approach were the McGill case in 1995, the IMS in the early 2000s, and recently the Microsoft case. Now, doctrinally, these decisions applied some version of the essential facilities doctrine, which may or may not exist in the US. As you can expect, these cases created a lot of controversy, and following this decision, conventional wisdom within the antitrust community, and especially I think in North America, has developed or became something more or less along the following line. Okay, so first, there's the observation that the application of the essential facility doctrines to IP is a point on which the two jurisdictions, the US and the EU, sharply diverge on. And again, common wisdom is that US law would never ever compel IP owners to license their intellectual property for merely refusing to license it. And then there comes an explanation saying that the reason why the two jurisdictions diverge is that the Europeans are generally much more willing to apply the essential facility doctrine to IP because they are more concerned about losing short-term benefits of increased competition, and they are less concerned about the negative effect that their approach might have on the incentive to innovate. Okay, and then conventional wisdom goes to point out that the US is exactly the opposite, that the US, in contrast, or US antitrust law, is much more concerned or cognizant about the long-term benefits of innovation, even at the expense of losses to short-term competition. And usually under this view, the conclusion is that the Americans got it right and the Europeans are wrong. Okay, although we have some dissenting views, such as Eleanor's paper that says, oh, maybe not so quick, maybe there is something to be learned from what the Europeans have been doing. Okay, so what our paper wants to challenge this conventional wisdom in the following way. Okay, so to date, the debate focused almost exclusively on the essential facilities doctrine. So I think the most modest claim in the paper is that we advocate looking beyond this particular doctrine. And the point is that looking only at one particular antitrust doctrine tells us very little about the jurisdiction's overall view regarding the optimal mix of competition and intellectual property protection. Okay, now the second step is going to say, okay, what when we expand our outlook and go beyond essential facilities, what do we see? Okay, so we argue that we go beyond essential facilities doctrine, actually a very different picture emerges than the one that the conventional wisdom tells us. That in fact, on the strong IP versus weak IP, or the strong antitrust versus weak antitrust axis, the US actually emerges as a weak IP with strong antitrust, okay, as contrary to what we ordinarily hear. Okay, so we look beyond essential facilities mainly in two directions. One direction is to ask how doctrines or rules that are internal to IP law address pro-competitive interests or pro-competitive concerns, and how such internal IP doctrines try minimizing the harm to innovative competition arising from the exercise of IP rights. And we show that while in the EU, in very limited circumstances, or while the EU tried in very specific circumstances, try to address these competitive concerns by invoking competition law from the outside, the US, at least in the area of copyright, systematically narrows the scope of copyright in order to foster innovative competition. So we show that US copyright law has indeed a robust set of doctrines that deny copyright or narrow the scope of copyright substantially in order to foster innovative competition. Examples of such rule could be the treatment of factual compilation and the rule that the facts themselves are always free for others to copy, the merger doctrine in copyright law, which is totally different than merger in antitrust, the fair use doctrine that is fundamental in US copyright law, copyright misuse that has some ambiguous status but seems to be taking food. So all of those doctrines limit copyright in order to foster innovative competition, and from our observation, from what we hope we get it right, that those doctrines barely exist in Europe, whereas they are part of the DNA of US copyright law. So that's a very important difference. So the result is that in key respect, the US has adopted a less is more approach to copyright. It protects copyright less vigorously in order to promote innovative competition. And that, of course, reduces the need to apply antitrust externally. OK, Okay, so the second direction of looking beyond essential facilities is to consider how antitrust law more generally impacts the exercise of IP rights, and we just look at a particular, not substantive rule, but actually procedure aspect of U.S. antitrust law, in particular the prevalence of private antitrust litigation, treble damages, class actions, discovery rules, and we think that the existence of all of those procedural aspects, which again rarely exist in Europe, creates a de facto much more restraining power of intellectual property rights in the United States compared to Europe.
Thanks.
Eleanor?
Thank you, and it is a pleasure, first, to be here, and second, it's always a pleasure to be here, I like it all the time, and second, Ariel, it's a pleasure to be able to comment on your paper. It is a very interesting paper and a very interesting and unique cut. I want to raise some questions. I'm not entirely convinced and in your thesis, but maybe with your response and more work, I will be convinced. All right, these are respects in which I think that maybe you ought to think a little further. First of all, you propose, of course, it's a very interesting thesis, and it's true in some cases, and it is certainly true in some cases you cite, that while U.S. antitrust law may be more respecting of intellectual property rights than Europe, that in some cases U.S. copyright law has less scope, and therefore there's less need for antitrust. In the first part of your paper, you entitle that Antitrust Regulation of IPRs in the United States and Europe, and you are talking about refusals to deal, refusals to license intellectual property rights. You look at the U.S. approach first, and you look at cases, whether or not copyright cases, such as Trinco, and you do come to a conclusion that U.S. antitrust is much more reluctant to condemn a party for refusing to deal, and that EU is somewhat more. But in my view, you minimize the gap between U.S. antitrust and refusals to deal and EU antitrust and refusals to deal. I think it is a gaping gap. I think, for example, that Aspen Ski has lesser vitality in view of Trinco and its progeny. You incidentally don't have to have an IP right to be entitled to refuse to deal. And the U.S. jurisprudence on the right to refuse to deal as a single firm is extremely strong. And on the other hand, the European jurisprudence, I think you might understate the differences because while U.S. is very reluctant to authorize an antitrust action for refusal to deal, European Union has shown that it is in many cases likely to condemn refuses to deal that involve intellectual property, and I want to come back to Microsoft in just a minute about that. So first of all, I think that gap is much bigger than you say. Secondly, is it true that copyright in US is really significantly less robust and less protective than copyright in Europe? And as you say in your paper, it's a matter for the member states in Europe, and also, as is clear, and you say in your paper, one of the biggest cases in point that you rely on is the IMS case, in which that copyright of Ireland, the copyright protection of Ireland, was idiosyncratically large. And I wonder whether, as a general matter in the member states in Europe, there is so much greater protection of intellectual property right, especially copyright. That, of course, is an empirical question. So thirdly, Your paper very interestingly talks about the substitutability between weaker copyright and stronger antitrust. And you cite a couple of cases in which that is true, including the New York Stock Exchange ICE case. However, and when the case comes up in the European Union, the claim is twofold, that workgroup server companies, such as Novell, which created workgroup server operating systems, was, when it was the creator and the one and only, it was welcomed by Microsoft to interconnect seamlessly with the Microsoft operating system. Then Microsoft copies it, it makes its own, and then it cuts down on the information that it's giving to Novell, making it much more difficult for Novell to operate seamlessly. And the claim was that Microsoft had the duty to give the full information, which the court in Europe said it did have the duty. And the second was a bundling case with Real Media Player and the operating system, where something similar happened. Real Networks pioneered the media player, and then Microsoft made its own, and then gave it much less good treatment and bundled its own. So this is my question. Supposing that case came up in the United States, and you mentioned maybe that kind of case would come up in the United States, and maybe a plaintiff would win. I think it's very doubtful after Trinco and Linkline that a United States plaintiff would win that case. So suppose a plaintiff wanting to bring that case, it might be the Justice Department in today's era, who knows. Suppose the plaintiff says, well, it's okay that we don't have strong antitrust on our side. US has weak copyright law. It's not a substitute. You can't pull out the weak copyright to win an antitrust case. Now, thirdly, I wanted to make a point about the scope of your paper, which is actually a lot narrower than the title of your paper. And I might suggest you might want to revise the title to meet the scope. The scope of your paper is about innovation and competitiveness, and innovation, intellectual property, antitrust, and competition policy across the Atlantic. It is, as you say many times in it, especially with respect to, and really with respect to, copyright. And you also say a couple of times in your paper that you believe, I know this is just a hypothesis, but that you believe that American firms are more innovative than EU, European firms, and that perhaps it has something to do with this mix between copyright protection and antitrust, and maybe it has something to do with the more reluctance of US to trump the intellectual property protection. As well as the other side on copyright. I want to suggest that if you're thinking in such a large vision, there's a lot of research and a lot of more steps that you might want to take on. Can you even link the two, because there's so many steps in between? Would you want to think about the other kinds of intellectual property, including patent? And I think in patents, it's very hard to say, it's very hard to say that US patent protection is weaker than European protection. And would you also want to think beyond this particular issue, an issue about if antitrust trumps intellectual property, does that give wrong incentives for innovation and make us weaker competitively? The European Union, this is where I'm coming back to Microsoft. The European Union often thinks about innovation aspects broadly, and much more broadly than protecting the intellectual property right. On the one side, if you protect the intellectual property right, say, of Microsoft, that would be a plus and a big plus for Microsoft as defendant. On the other side, the European Union asked, in those very cases that I was just, the two instances I just mentioned, on workgroup server and the bundling, the European Court asked whether there would be more innovation by requiring Microsoft to deal, by requiring Microsoft to give full interoperability information and requiring and prohibiting Microsoft from bundling its media player unless it also provides an avenue for others' media player. So the innovation question is really so much broader than the questions, the internal questions about how broad a scope does copyright protection have. One word about essential facilities. I think the debate today is mostly not on essential facilities. I'm even wondering whether you should have that in your title. Even in the three cases that you mentioned in the EU, they're not essential facility cases. They're close to it, but they don't mention essential facility. I think that might be partly because people realize today that so much baggage is attached to that so-called doctrine of essential facility, that jurisdictions want to stay away from saying, I'm arguing an essential facility case. They never wanted to say in Europe, Microsoft is an essential facility. So I was thinking that maybe your new title might not even have essential facility in it. And I know that your paper is meant to be descriptive too, right? It's not so much normative, but for a longer range project, and I'm sure you're working on longer range projects in areas of innovation, for a longer range project, it would be very interesting to hear your views on the right interface between antitrust law and intellectual property, when the intellectual property is not going to disappear when you blow at it for a misuse doctrine or something, but the intellectual property is there and the antitrust is there, and how do you determine the point at which one should be superior over the other? So I think it's a very interesting, very provocative paper, and I enjoyed reading it very much. Thanks.
Jay.
Also thought it was very interesting and provocative and very ambitious. It's hard because there's no metric here that you can set up and say, well, okay, let me measure the degree of intellectual property protection that exists under the law, and now let me measure the extent of antitrust intervention that we can see, and if I reduce one, then the other goes up. I mean, you postulated that as a general proposition, but there's no real way to measure it. So it becomes, I think, a product of how deeply you really probe the levels of protection that exist under either set of rules. And I would agree that I don't think the probing is deep enough. In part, I think the excision of patents from the discussion, Eleanor mentioned this, is really artificial, because if you're going to try to assess the degree of intellectual property that exists in the U.S., I think you've got to assess it along at least patents and copyright. There's just nothing in here that does that. It would be a tougher task, but I think it's probably worth doing if you wanted to make this comparison. I also had some trouble with the comparison to Microsoft, in part, I guess, because I see one of the places in this program where I know a little bit of fact. You have an interesting circumstance, which is that both the U.S. and the EC have affirmative licensing provisions in the two cases for what is essentially the same technology. The interoperability information is substantially the same in the two areas, and much of the European material is the result of U.S. disclosures and the IP work that had to be done in the U.S. Yet the approaches were quite different in the two places. When we negotiated the interoperability provisions, we didn't. We called for reasonable and non-discriminatory licensing royalty provisions. And and we thought a lot about that when we both negotiated and subsequently had to assess the royalty levels that Microsoft was asking. The Europeans, were much more prepared to actually assess the intellectual value or the value of the intellectual property that was going to be required to be licensed, had very little hesitation to conclude that it wasn't worth very much at all, and as a result fined Microsoft a very substantial sum of money for charging too much and making the technology available too late. You would have to say that we in the U.S., at least from a negotiated point of view, and we certainly weren't courts, were valuing the intellectual property much more highly than the Europeans were. And ultimately, of course, the Europeans were able to force what amounted to a nominal royalty rate and open up the interoperability information to open source, which was something we never thought about doing here in the U.S. We thought it was literally beyond the pale. So that suggests to you that maybe you have to think some more about whether our dilution of intellectual property interests in the U.S. is really making up for the failure to exercise antitrust constraints the same way that the Europeans do. You have at the sort of kind of tacked on at the end of your paper the procedural mechanisms that you referred to, the treble damage action, free discovery rights and private enforcement mechanisms. I kind of thought that was tacked on. It didn't fit very well with the rest of the paper, and your the rest of the paper is sort of designed to deal with the notion that that in the U.S. we've opened up the competition area by diluting the copyright protection. I'm maybe overstating these terms, but that was the idea. The fact that you then build on procedural mechanisms that encourage antitrust cases doesn't really have a lot to do with your central thesis that we're balancing intellectual property law against antitrust, and I thought it was kind of misplaced. And if you took it out of your paper, you'd probably focus better on what you really want to talk about. One other area that I thought it's hard to if you're going to talk about how much or how little the U.S. and the EC value intellectual property, I think you have to look at their attitude towards digital rights management as well, as a very, very important feature these days on copyright. And unless you're prepared to look at that, you can't really understand the level of intellectual property protection that exists today.
Ariel, would you want to respond?
Oh yeah, I'd love to. these are all great comments and things these are all great comments and things that I could, I think many of them give myself on my own if I had to. I'll start, Jay, with your last comment at the DRM, and I mean this kind of project that I think one of the danger in the project is that it can be so huge that I'm actually guilty of the same crime that I'm accusing either. Okay, I'm just looking on a set of features and then trying to make broader broader conclusion about the policy or the approach of a jurisdiction. So one thing is that I think I know quite a bit about U.S. copyright law. I don't know as much about European copyright law or IP law, and I don't know much about what else might be there in Europe that I'm totally unaware of, but which can actually have much more constraining effect that, and I'm ignoring that. So for that reason, that's why I think I have a few levels of argument. So one is that we actually should not focus on only just one doctrine, but it's important that we look on how this doctrine is situated within a much broader institutional and legal and cultural and so on. And once we do that, we can get different conclusions. But nonetheless, I do think that there is a difference in the way U.S. Copyright law treats, and that there are important differences. But it's difficult to pin out. So that's what I said in the last of my comment. I think it's something in the DNA. It's the way the Americans think about copyright that my sense is that Europeans don't. Okay, they think about the issues differently. So they may have some statutory exceptions that they built into, but then they are treated as exceptions, should be interpreted very narrowly in a much more formal and technical manner, in a way that is very different or alien to the way American courts do. And I think part of this, and that's why I connect this to the procedural mechanisms. I didn't have time to develop this in the paper, but that's why I think it is important, is that in the US, these are the same federal courts that, okay, so a case can start with an IP infringement lawsuit, but then quite often, at least that's under my observation, the IP defendant responds by counterclaiming and bringing antitrust counterclaim.
More often, though, in the patent context than in the copyright context.
Okay, yeah. Well, I'll get to the patent in a second. But that actually brings...
I do note I'm off already over time, so... Yeah, we have a break. I'm intruding there. But.
Cut him some slack. Okay.
Yeah. But that actually creates an opportunity for the court to get a much more complicated view or complex view of what's going on. What are the implications of ruling one way or the other? So that comes from some of the procedural aspects of the U.S., which I think my observation currently does not exist to the same degree in the US. Now, just about patents, the reason why I focus on copyright here is, okay, practically, the paper is already long, so I cannot encompass everything. Secondly, the three main cases in Europe, okay, so there are the two ones, the McGill and IMS dealt with copyright. Microsoft dealt with something that, I mean, you know, but I nobody really told me what's the IP there. Okay, so the court says even if there is IP, which we don't know what it is, then it doesn't prevent us from compelling its license.
It was copyright and trade secrets in the end, especially, and patents.
Yeah,
and patents.
So it's
yes.
Everything.
Yeah.
Okay, now, but in addition, okay, so I think it gives me a reason to say, okay, at least in most of the cases where composite license was actually given in the US, it was copyright. And that's one reason. The other thing is that I think this is an area, when you talk about the IP regime, that there is divergence in the IP. I don't know much to what extent such divergence exists in patents, but I think it's also interesting to see that in the area of patents, there is at least a series of recent cases, so the MedImmune and KSR and eBay versus Merck exchange, and we'll see what comes out of Bilski, right. That it seemed that maybe a similar process is beginning in the patent area. Okay, that the Supreme Court start thinking about patent law from an antitrust, kind of antitrust point of view, or with antitrust consideration in mind. So that's, Shubha Ghosh made his comment, and Bill Hilliard, so maybe we see similar developments happening in patent, but that's just a speculation. Do I have more time?
Well, I committed to Spencer that I'd let him comment.
Okay, and I promise I won't say anything nice about essential facilities or bad about Trinco. But I do have I share one comment that I want to reinforce that Jay said, which is right now the procedural stuff does feel a little tacked on to me, and I really would recommend that if it's important to you, you expand it or cut it. And if you expand it, I think you need a little more nuance about the importance of, you're factually correct about the procedural differences between the two systems, but I think you need to recognize that private antitrust litigation outside treble damage price fixing claims is not a growth industry. where, you know, right now the bar is laboring under new and unclear pleading requirements that the Supreme Court has, you know, created in a couple recent cases. Class actions in general are not a growth industry, and the courts are becoming increasingly strict in different ways about them. And I'd only point out that, of course, we have these different mechanisms that Europe doesn't have, but the kinds of cases that you're talking about don't happen to typically be class actions in our system.
Unless they are patent cases, I think.
Yeah, I just meant the ones, yeah. You know, the kinds of ones you're talking about in the copyright and the counterclaim context. So I'd either say go bigger or leave that for a separate mm-hmm. day. Oh, and then finally, one other thing, you made a little comment about maybe in the paper, maybe IP is less politicized in the United States than other issues, including antitrust. There's a professor at DePaul named Matt Sag,
yes.
who actually has empirical work that strongly supports that, mm-hmm. that very claim.
Yes.
Unfortunately, I think we're out of time. Thank you, everyone.